great name. Aurelio, and, but he went by Harry.
That was like 20 years, people have a passed away.
Okay. Why Harry? Aurelio is a wonderful name.
That's what my mother always told me.
Victor is fairly direct, but two are strong names. So I'm just kind of curious, the Ferraro side of the family, how many are there or here?
Four of them, yeah.
Okay, oh. And the Malafronte?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's Francisco Michelin.
Hi, Paula.
Hi, hi. Yeah. I'm sorry for your loss. Well, it doesn't matter the age, it was your mom. Yeah. And,
Marty.
Marty. I'm going to lose my mask here. Named after Grandpa. All right. Well, maybe I'll let the rest go. But, how's the last time that everybody's gotten together? Or is this the first time in a long time? So she's still having parties.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. And really, it's an important time for you as a family, and for any family. I realize that there's always sadness surrounding a death of an individual, and some of it is kind of age-dependent. If it's somebody younger, there just seems to be a stronger feeling for that. And when it's somebody older, it's like, well, yeah, it's kind of her time. You can say that, but nonetheless, it doesn't matter what the years are, what the time is. This is somebody who's given you life, and really because of that, the rest of you who are here, and the overwhelming majority of you. So there is a direct connection here, and it's a wonderful time, especially for you, for grandchildren and great-grandchildren, an opportunity to be able to get together, to tell the stories, remember, maybe to hear things that you've never heard before about who you are as a family. And I hope that you take the time in some way, and it may not be today or tomorrow, maybe once this all kind of calms down very quickly, and in the blink of an eye. And it really is so important to know where you've come from and what your story is. We don't live in the past, but it's that past that's a part of who it is we are for every tomorrow, and it really is important. So I'm glad to see Micheline here, and something that I was thinking about coming over here, how did your mom fit into, you know, into the scheme of things with her siblings? Was she the youngest?
She was the second youngest, yeah.
Okay.
And three of them really had
I was thinking, coming over here, you know, when we celebrate our birthdays, and it will be 1 year, it's at the completion of that year. So we've already been around for a whole year before we actually celebrate a birthday. So, I mean, Micheline is 98, so she's already been around 99 years. And I'm thinking for the 9 months before that she would have been conceived, just about a century ago. And you know what was going on a century ago? And what people looked like in the Bronx when they got together to do something that we're doing here,
yeah.
They looked just like you and me with masks on. Mm-hmm. So I'm just, there's a connection here a century later. So this is an important part of the story, and I hope you can make that connection and know that. Yeah, that means all the more to me in that connection, knowing her age, because I was wondering, how old is this one? And now knowing that, all the more directly connected. Okay. Well, we bring this time to the Lord, even as Michelina is bringing us together, you together as a family, and calling you together in prayer. That's something powerful that I know she's done for you many times over, as I've seen her in church, and she's still doing that right now, I'm sure. So it's in that spirit and in that solidarity that we call upon our God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My friends, as we gather this evening, we come trusting and believing that all of the ties of friendship and affection which knit us as one throughout our lives do not unravel with death. And confident that God always remembers the good that we have done and forgives us of our sins, let us pray this night, asking the Lord to gather Michelina to himself. Lord our God, the death of our sister Michelina recalls our human condition and the brevity of our lives here on earth. But for those who believe in your love, death is not the end, nor does it destroy the bonds that you forge in our lives. We share the faith of your Son's disciples and the hope of the children of God. Bring the light of Christ's resurrection to this time of remembrance, of thanksgiving, of mourning, as we pray for Michelina and for those who love her. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. I would invite, please, that we might pray together Psalm 139. And we can do that very simply by responding, Lord, you know me and you love me. Well, Lord, you search me and you know me. You know my resting and my rising. You discern my purpose from afar. You mark when I walk or lie down. All my ways lie open to you. Lord, you know me and you love me. Before ever a word is on my tongue, you know it, O Lord, through and through. Behind and before, you besiege me, your hand ever laid upon me. Too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach. Lord, you know me and you love me. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your face? If I climb to the heavens, you are there. If I lie in the grave, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn and dwell at the sea's furthest end, even there your hand would lead me, your right hand would hold me fast. Lord, you know me and you love me. If I say, let the darkness hide me and the light around me be night, even darkness is not dark for you, and the night is as clear as the day. For it was you who created my being, knit me together in my mother's womb. I thank you for the wonder of my being, for the wonders of all your creation. Lord, you know me and you love me. Already you knew my soul. My body held no secret from you when I was being fashioned in secret and molded in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw all of my actions. They were all written in your book. Every one of my days was decreed before one of them came into being. Lord, you know me and you love me. To me how mysterious your thoughts, the sum of them not to be numbered. If I count them, they are more than the sand, and to finish, I must be eternal like you. But search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. See that I follow not the wrong path, and lead me in the path of life eternal. Lord, you know me and you love me. I share with you this evening a reading from St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. We know that if our earthly dwelling, a tent, should be destroyed, we have a building from God, a dwelling not made with hands, but eternal in heaven. So we are always courageous, although we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yet we are courageous, and we would rather leave the body and go home to the Lord. Therefore, we aspire to please God, whether we are at home or away, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive recompense according to what they did in the body, whether good or evil. The word of the Lord. As we gather this evening, we're reminded of the frailty of our own bodies, and yet the incredible resilience as well. As someone who's kind of picked up the pieces a number of times over the course of the last 98 years, with two husbands that you carry, and a family that she's forged together, and the generations that she's shared her life, her love, and her faith with. And still with that kick-up spirit is, I suspect, a lot that you have a lot to hold on to and to remember, and really to celebrate and to give thanks. I know her faith was strong because I saw her in church all the time. And that is something that was like a serious obligation that she had to do that out of fear or something. But always with a smile on her face and always glad to be there. And something that she did out of love for the Lord. And I suspect if she were asked, then we'll put it into words, out of love for you as well. And that's why she was there. As part of our prayer this evening, invite maybe just for a few moments. Sometimes people like to share a little story. I know there's a lot of pictures here, so I expect there to be a lot of stories as well. But if there's something brief, or just a brief thought or something, maybe some way, and I'm just kind of curious with the generations that are here, especially from the younger ones, what are you going to remember about your grandmother, your great-grandmother? It's very rare to have somebody around that long and in a way physically present for the most part for all these years. So what did she like to do as a mom? What did she, what will kind of stick in your minds as what to cook? Did she have a specialty?
Lasagna.
What kind of cookies?
She makes both a pan and a honey bowl. She does.
And the reason that I say that, too, is that's good to talk about, because sometimes it kind of skips, and oftentimes it's the younger ones that I should have asked those questions, you know, back those years ago. Is there anything in writing? And I know from my own generation, I'm going back to stories about my grandparents and younger cousins of mine who are trying to pick up pieces from people that came from, in my family, from Sweden, from Russia, from Central America. And, I mean, some of the stuff we've been able to find miraculously, but most of it, and I'm thinking to myself, there's a couple of individuals that were around this long, and we talked about it a lot of times. So I've got to sit down and interview Grandma, and we've got to do this. And because my grandmother, Corinne, from Sweden, lived to be 101.
Wow.
And she was clear almost to the end.
Wow.
And I can't tell you how many times I kick myself now. It's like all those stories. And she came from a family of 13 brothers and sisters.
Wow.
And there's another whole story on the other side of the ocean and a connection that I have no idea. There's ways that you can do it, do it. It's not going to be something that everybody's going to do, but if there's a couple in the group,
mm-hmm.
it's an important part.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so good cook. What else did she like to do?
She liked to dance.
Did she? Okay. And how about Harry and Victor? Do they like to dance as well?
No, not Victor.
Harry, I don't know about him because he died when we were really young. But,
my father died when he was 33.
I was five.
My sister was 11 months old. My brother was five. He was very young.
But Victor, no. He always said, real men don't dance.
Thank you, Harry and Brolin.
But you always end up dancing with Uncle Joe.
Yeah.
Uncle Joe was a dancer.
There's something that I read in the obituary that I'm really very curious about. What was the family business that she was the bookkeeper for?
Oh, my grandfather owned the shoe factory.
Oh.
Miller Shoes.
In Manhattan.
Wow.
Yeah, in Manhattan.
New
York City.
Wow.
Yeah. She actually did. She didn't like doing the bookkeeping as much. She liked being out and actually manufacturing the shoes.
Making the shoes.
She loved the girls in the office were too gossipy.
I like to work with her hands. I think that's part of the cooking. She liked crocheting. She did a lot of crocheting.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. Well, these are the things that I hope that you share with one another.
She was a freshman era female, so she didn't get much education, but she was extremely smart.
Yes, yeah, she was.
Very, very smart.
And again, there's something about the folks from that time. They didn't let the weight of the world hold them down. Yeah. I mean, it's not to say that everybody's like that. There are plenty of people that just got crushed. But the ones that didn't, they really, it doesn't surprise me that she enjoyed dancing. And that probably all kinds of other stuff like that. That it's just that energy, that spirit, that through all the stuff, it just kind of rose up.
She didn't have any
negative
feelings.
Bring that together, and we bring it to prayer in a way that can we connect with the very words that Jesus has given us when we share this evening. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Amen. Lord Jesus, our Redeemer, you willingly gave yourself up to death so that all might be saved and pass from death to life. We humbly ask you to comfort this family, their friends who gather around them this night, and to receive Michelina into the arms of your mercy. You alone are the Holy One. You are mercy itself. By dying, you unlock the gates of life for those who believe in you. Forgive Michelina of any of her sins and grant her a place of happiness, light, and peace in the kingdom of your glory forever and ever. Amen. Blessed are those who have died in the Lord. Let them rest from their labors, for their good deeds go with them. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May she rest in peace. Amen. And may her soul and all the souls of the faithful departed, the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. May the Lord bless and keep you, guide you on the journey that we continue to travel. Lift your spirits when the weight of the world is crushing down, and keep a smile on your face in the best of times and in the most challenging of times. Our God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks, everybody. You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm glad to see when people, sometimes they don't, but families for the most part, go digging through all those, the family albums and then everything else and put pictures out on the boards and fair, since it's not what I do or what we do at Mass. All of this is all part of the prayer. That's important to recognize it. So she's brought you together as a family for the celebration of her life, and maybe even more importantly, of your life. It may sound a little strange, but enjoy it. It's holy time, and it's meant to be celebrated. And we don't want to do that.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. We'll see you tomorrow. Mass will be at 10:15 in church tomorrow. It gives us enough time after morning Mass to sanitize the church, and then the next group is in, and things will be safe and clean and quiet for it. Now, do we have readers for tomorrow? We're still not.
Nadine said so. She's going to do the reading.
Yeah, we haven't. Thank you. We're still, I keep forgetting that. We're still limited with movement, and even some of the things that traditionally we would do, we're not doing yet, and probably won't for quite some time. So tomorrow, when you come in, you'll come right up and be seated, and then the casket will be brought forward, and we'll begin the prayers from there. Usually that happens in the middle of the church, but yeah, we try to limit the movement as much as possible.
You can process out then.
I won't. You'll still process out, and there'll be music, but I'll be staying in the sanctuary.
You go out behind the casket?
Yes, the castle will lead you out tomorrow. Yeah. Your mom will send you on your way. She'll be leading the way. Now you're going to the Bronx from here?
Queens.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So you'll still have a procession along the way, and she'll still be leading the way. It's like a little lead car.
So small in stature.
Right.
Big in heart. And as gentle as she was, she could be a very powerful person. Mm-hmm. Especially when we're younger.
They're not surprised at all.
Eight kids, and but with their clean clothes. And yeah, a very strong one.
Well, the Lord gave it to us. That would be a good one.
It's very, very strong. Very, very strong. Pray for all of us constantly.
I did that right now.
No doubt it's true.
Probably. I suspect it is.
And we just commented earlier, there's going to be some real dynamite people or something like that.
Well, there's a lot of new cooks I know that I've sent up that way, so.
Well, Anya was telling me, but now it's who he is.